What topic are we covering today? Monkey. Okay, that's right. So we're going to talk about science-y things today. Now, as a word of warning, we will probably not be talking about very much actual science, at least in the main part of the talking that I'm doing. Our discussion afterwards, I'm sure, will focus mostly on science. But it's really a slightly different question that we'll deal with today, and we'll get into that in a minute. I just don't want you to be too disappointed when we don't start talking about radiocarbon dating in the middle of the talk, okay? I do have a slide for that, but we're not going to go over it right now. Importantly, while these lectures, I mean, they're not really lectures, these events that we do every Thursday here are supported by Ratio Christi, that does not mean that the things that we talk about or the things in the slides are necessarily things that the national organization would endorse. There will be things we will talk about that they don't endorse, because that's what we do. We talk about things that are maybe on the edges of acceptable, and we explore them. So don't call up Corey Miller and tell us that we're spewing heresy. We're not trying to speak for Ratio Christi National. We are just trying to provide you guys with some of the different ways that different people think about these issues. So this is the topic for tonight, which is basically that, so this semester we've been talking about the gospel and objections to the gospel. So broadly speaking, the key Christian message. But there are many people who are not even going to listen to you about the gospel, because they're going to say that all of this is irrelevant, because this is based on a completely foreign worldview that doesn't match with all of the things that we know in the modern world from science. So how can the gospel be true if it's based on just purely false ideas about history and cosmology and biology and anthropology and geology and on and on and on? Or in other words, if Jesus, why monkey, right? So here's what we really mean. So as some of you guys know who have been coming for a while, we like to frame these questions in terms of a dialogue between two hypothetical people, Carol the Christian and Alvin the Atheist. What is that? I can't
hear you if you do that. Oh, sorry about that.
So Alvin says to Carol, "I don't care what the gospel teaches. It's based on incorrect ancient science. Why should I believe what the Bible says about spiritual things if it gets science so wrong?" Okay? And like I said a minute ago, three of the key areas of potential contradiction here are cosmology, biology, and anthropology. So that is the study of the universe as a whole, especially the age of the universe, the study of the origin of life and the potential interrelatedness of life, and then, of course, the origin and story of humanity. So there are, if we try to take this argument that Alvin is making and we try to make it a little bit more formal, there's a couple of different things that he might be saying. The first one would maybe be that the Bible is teaching falsehoods regarding science, therefore it's untrustworthy about spiritual matters. The second might be that the gospel message is fundamentally based on or built upon scientific or historical claims that are false. Which would mean that it's false. So we're going to talk a little bit about both of these types of objections today. So here's the first one. We're going to write it out in an actual syllogism, in a formal argument format, so that we can think about what we're really claiming here. So if the Bible teaches scientific errors, then the Bible is untrustworthy in spiritual matters. Okay? The Bible teaches scientific errors, therefore the Bible is untrustworthy in spiritual matters. So who knows what this argument structure is called? Anybody?
Modus ponens.
Yeah, so it's a deductive argument and it's a modus ponens. How do you get out of an argument like this? If you don't like the conclusion, how do you get out of the argument?
Because the first statement doesn't necessarily, it's inconsistent with the conclusion.
So you can say that the first premise is false, or you can say that the second premise is false. If either of those are false, then the argument fails, right? So we can choose either of these. And there's different ways that we can address the truth or falsehood of either of these premises. We're just going to talk kind of briefly and generally about some approaches that you can take. This is not at all exhaustive, okay? So the first option, we can just deny the first premise. We can say, yes, the Bible does teach scientific errors, and this is not a problem. Does that make anybody uncomfortable?
Yes.
Okay, yes. So obviously, your Christian friends are not going to like you for taking this option. But something that I want to frame this whole thought about, remember, this is Ratio Christi. The purpose of this organization is evangelism and apologetics, right? So what we are doing is interacting with people who aren't Christians. So what I'm doing today isn't, the intent isn't to give you an argument for yourself that's consistent with your particular systematic theology. The intent is to think about how can you argue with somebody who doesn't believe, and if your goal is to get them to consider the gospel, do you really have to also assume something like the inerrancy of Scripture? Okay? So we'll touch on that again at the end, but this is just something I want you to think about. Now, we're not going to talk much more about this tact because it'd be better probably if we didn't have to use this particular argument. At Ratio Christi, we do essentially assume inerrancy, so we will discuss this, but this is the position that we hold as an organization, biblical inerrancy, typically as specified in the Chicago Statement on Biblical Inerrancy, which for some reason nobody thought to actually create a statement on inerrancy of the Bible until like 50 years ago, so think about that a little bit. We do have some previous meeting topics where we talked about inerrancy. But we're going to take this as kind of our starting assumption. Okay, so what else can we do to address this question? So if we don't want to go the first route, and there are other ways that you could deny that first premise that might not be inerrancy, but just for the sake of argument, let's think about this second premise. The Bible teaches scientific errors. Is this premise true? Let me ask this, what would it mean for this, what would have to be the case in order for this premise to be true?
There's a case where Jesus refers to the mustard seed as like the smallest seed.
Okay, so there's an example.
But I think that most people say that's not an example of a taught scientific error.
Yeah, so that term teaches is important.
In order for the Bible to teach scientific errors to be a thing, it has to be intending to teach a scientific viewpoint and have that viewpoint be wrong. It has to be both of those things.
Sure. Mm-hmm. Anybody else have anything they want to add to that?
I was going to say that it discusses a resurrection. But
okay.
Different time.
Maybe this comes into a hermeneutic, but it has to be talking to people who'd be looking to interpret it that way to begin with.
Yeah, that's a good point. We're going to get there in a minute. So I think you guys have hit it on the head. There are basically two things that have to be true for this to be true. The Bible has to be teaching a scientific claim, making a scientific claim, and that claim has to be false. So both of those things have to obtain. So this is the question we're going to ask. Does the Bible make false scientific errors? And we are going to zoom in on just the first 11 chapters of Genesis here, okay? Because this is really the most relevant part. We can easily dismiss the mustard seed thing, and there are a few other isolated instances that you might want to talk about, but Genesis 1 to 11, this is the battleground, okay? This is the point where people get up in arms about what we're talking about. So, okay. Let me take a step back here. The question we're really asking here, that we're focusing on right now, is what does the Bible actually teach? So remember I said there are two ways that you can address, you know, that question, or that premise has to achieve. It has to be teaching something, and that thing has to be false. Now, we're not really going to talk about the scientific side of things. We're not going to talk that much about the specific scientific evidences and things like that. So we're not going to talk about what the true science is very much. The first question is, what does the Bible actually teach? As Christians, this is properly the first question for us to ask before we ever look at or think about science. What does the Bible actually teach? Now, when we're looking at the Genesis 1 to 11, the primary question that we are asking is, how do we interpret this first third of the book of Genesis? And the broad, kind of spectrum that we can look at is from literalistic interpretations to highly non-literal and figurative interpretations. And so the question that we're asking is, where on that scale do we fall? Is the Bible making claims about how long ago the earth was created? Or how long it took God to create the earth? Or whether or not man was formed by, sculpting him out of mud, right? So this is the question that we're asking here. Now, there are, we're basically going to consider two broad spectrum, or two points on this spectrum. We're going to think about the far ends, okay? On the literal side, there are two groups of people who fall into the far end of literalism. And we can term these the Neo-Assyrians, so those who are following the biblical chronology of Bishop Usher from a few hundred years ago. On the other hand, we can talk about the theological liberals, the first group of those being in the 19th century in Germany, and then there have been further groups that have leaned this direction that we might also term liberals in some way. I'm not meaning that as a pejorative term. That's just a convenient label that we're going to use to group a bunch of people with disparate views together into one label so that we can talk about them as if they all believe the same thing. Now, these two groups, basically, they believe the same thing, that you should take the first 11 chapters of Genesis very, very literally. And then the consequence of that is that the Neo-Assyrians say that, yes, you should do this, and consequently, all of science must be wrong because it's in contradiction with the Bible. The liberals say, obviously, it's just errors in Genesis because it's in contradiction with what we know about the natural world. So the two sides of the coin on the literal side of the spectrum. But are there views that are non-literal that are acceptable? And we'll talk about what that acceptable might mean. So how do we interpret the Bible? So this task is called biblical hermeneutics. So this is the science of interpreting a text, particularly scripture. What you're doing when you're reading the Bible is trying to discover or uncover the meaning. But where does the meaning come from? What do you guys think? Like, when you're reading a text, doesn't have to be the Bible, anything. Like, what is the source of the meaning of the words that you are reading?
The author.
Okay, the author. Anybody else have a different thought?
It kind of depends on how you want to look at it, right?
Maybe. Mm-hmm. So who's familiar with constitutional law? There's a school of constitutional law called textualism. You guys know who Neil Gorsuch is? He's a textualist. So a textualist, in the context of constitutional law, thinks that the meaning is actually in the words of the text, okay? Okay, so basically we have three options here. We can say that the meaning is in the eye of the beholder. It's in the reader. This is subjectivism, this is a lot of what you get in more postmodern literary theories. I think we probably all agree that this isn't the way we want to go. We can debate that later if we have somebody who thinks differently. Or you can say it's in the text. This is not really a good choice either, though, as I think you probably are all recognizing. You might call this the word study trap. Just because you can show that a word means something in one context doesn't mean it means something in a different context. So the real source of meaning is the author. The author is trying to communicate something to you, and they are the source of the meaning in the text. Now, what that means is that sometimes it's possible for the meaning to be lost. So if you have an author who's so different from you, in a different environment, thinking differently from you, and all you have is their words and nothing to frame them, no context, it might be impossible for you to actually discover the meaning, which makes people uncomfortable. They would much rather the meaning to just be in the words. So I can read the words, and obviously I know what the words mean, right? It's English or whatever language you're reading. But we're gonna assume this, you know, the typical view that this is where the meaning comes from. It comes from the author. So how do you interact with an ancient author? So imagine Genesis. We don't know who wrote Genesis. Historically, it's believed to have been Moses. Those who say that Moses wrote it down, though, also don't think that he probably originally composed it. More contemporary scholars might even think that maybe it was written more like in the Babylonian exile or post-exile. But the key is, we don't know what the whole textual history of it is. We don't know necessarily who the author was in great detail. So how do you cooperate with an ancient author like this when you don't really know, you don't even necessarily know who they are for sure? So the concept here is cooperation. So you have to come at the text trying to discover what the author is meaning. You can't impose your own framework onto the text. You have to cooperate with the author. And this is very hard, especially when the author is separated from you in distance and time and culture and, you know, literary form. So this is important. If you fail to do this, you can create jokes. So I have a nice little joke that William Lane Craig likes to repeat on this topic. So he says, there's a knock at the door, and a man tells his robot, "Robot, go answer the door." And the robot dutifully approaches the door and says, "Yes, door, what was it that you asked?" Okay, stupid joke, but the point is, that is the literal meaning of those words. Like, that is a legitimate interpretation of what those words mean, but it is also very obvious that that's not what the author means. So in that case, the robot is not cooperating with the author, because the robot doesn't understand the context that what that phrase means in context. So there's a couple of different ways that we can think about texts. So we want to think about what a text is, what the form of it is, to understand what its meaning is. Now, there are lots of different dimensions that we can think about when we're looking at literature. Two of them are the type of language that's involved, from technical language to poetic language. Another one might be the literary form. So is it a poem? Is it prose narrative? Is it reporting or law or prose discourse? Those are all different forms, literary forms. And these are not the same thing. These are two different dimensions. So a lot of times people make this mistake and they say, because this isn't poetry, it's not a poem, that therefore it is a narrative, which is not the case, or that it has to be taken literally. Also not the case, because there are narratives that are poetic, for example, because those are two different things. So this is important. There's a lot of people that make this confusion. And there are a lot of different literary forms and types of language in the Bible. Here we can see the Psalms are clearly poetic, and they are poetry. They are very poetic poetry. Genesis 1 to 11 is very poetic prose narrative. Ecclesiastes is poetic discourse. Leviticus is very technical discourse. So the point here is that you do need to understand the type of literature. You need to understand what the literature is before you can understand the conventions that the author is using. So we can call this the shared world. So when an author writes to his audience, there's a lot of things that he doesn't have to tell them about, right? So I can talk about donkeys and elephants to you, and I don't have to tell you that those are symbols of political parties, right? I don't have to explain that to you because that's part of our shared world. But if you're not in that shared world, it becomes very confusing. Go read like political commentary of a different country, and you'll realize really quickly that you have no idea what they're talking about, because they're using things like these like donkeys and elephants to mean things, and you don't know what it is because you're not part of their shared world. So a part of understanding a text is actually discovering what the shared world is. Again, it's not easy. So how can we understand what a text is? We can group all these different dimensions together into a category called genre. So a genre is a grouping of texts that all have similar structure, language, purpose, and audience. So if we understand something about the entire genre, then we can start to understand how to interpret, you know, some individual example of that genre. Question from Sam?
Does language mean like the words or like the actual language, i.e. works in two?
It could mean both of those things. So obviously you might have a genre that exists in multiple languages, but you might have a genre that is constrained to one language or a family of languages. The genres that we're interested in are pretty much constrained to Semitic languages, plus Egyptian maybe, which is a different language family. But basically all these different things can be grouped together in genre, and you've probably all been told about understanding the genre when you're reading a text, when you're reading the Bible in particular, right? Has anybody not been told that before? Okay, you've probably all heard it. A great example of this is the book of Revelation, right? That is a very specific genre of literature called apocalyptic, or Jewish apocalyptic literature. Same thing as Daniel and Ezekiel, right? And importantly, there are tons of other examples of that type of literature from the Second Temple period, so we can start to understand the conventions of the literature. So we know that when Revelation is talking about the beast and talking about, you know, the dragons coming out of the sea, that these are symbols for political entities and all sorts of, you know, crazy things. But that he's not actually talking about a dragon coming up out of the ocean. Right? To do that is to completely misunderstand an entire genre of literature that has been well known for a long time. So what is the genre of Genesis 1 to 11? Does anybody have a guess? What would you call the genre?
I've usually heard it as very similar to like a temple sort of theology, setting up a temple.
Yeah, so there's a one guy in particular called John Walton who defends the position that especially Genesis 1 is about, well, maybe even Genesis 2, I guess, is about, is like parallel to setting up a temple. That wouldn't be quite a genre, but it is a similarity. Yeah, those are more technical language. So I wouldn't say they're the same genre, but there's a similarity there that some people find. You're right there. The book is called The Lost World of Genesis by John Walton. He's not the only one who defends that, though. There are others. Anybody else have a thought? What might the genre of Genesis be? Any thoughts?
Artistic, majestic.
So some people have used the term exalted prose to describe it. That may not be a whole genre, but you're getting, it's like prose, but it's very stylized. It's not poetry. At least not all of 1 to 11 for sure isn't poetry.
I've heard it called like a creation myth or a creation narrative. Myth not necessarily meaning false, mm-hmm. but just meaning sort of a mythos storyline.
Yeah, so myth or creation narrative. Any other thoughts? I mean, we can say some things it's not. It's not like a technical historical account, right? It doesn't read like the Gospels. It's not an ancient biography or it's not like the Book of Kings or Chronicles, right? Very different. It's not an apocalypse.
You can also rule out a lot of authors.
I mean, you can rule out a lot of authors that aren't like really old.
Yep.
But again, there's a lot of debate on the composition of different parts of Genesis 1 to 11.
But we know it wasn't by Isaacson, who does a lot of power history.
Yes. So some of the options. History, it's obviously not straightforward history like Kings or Chronicles. It's not a chronicle. Poetry, it's obviously also not a poetry, not a poem, right? It's not a psalm, but it does have poetic language. So we already threw this word out there. What about myth? What does that mean? And does that frighten you a little bit? Does it make you a little bit uncomfortable? Okay, that's to be expected. So let's talk about this. What does this mean? So first thing, I think just as we just said a moment ago, we're not talking about myth in the common sense of the word, which is to say we're not talking about something that's just a false story or like an archetypal theme. This is a technical definition of a class of literature that many cultures have. It's a sacred narrative which explains how the world and man came to be in their present form. So that's clearly what Genesis 1 to 11 is doing, right? It's basically providing this etiology, this reasoning for things being the way they are. It's a sacred narrative, and it also has stylistic similarities, specifically to ancient Near Eastern myths, although there are very important differences too, which we might talk about briefly. So this is a genre. This is an existing genre of literature. There are other examples of literature in this genre and similar genres that we can look at from the ancient Near East, from Babylon and Assyria and Samaria and similar places. Now, I said there were some important differences, though. There is something almost completely unique about Genesis 1 to 11, especially compared to most of the other ancient Near Eastern myths from Israel's neighbors, which is that there are these genealogies that are part of the story and that are the characters of the story. So when we talk about God forming Adam out of the dust of the earth, then there's a genealogy that basically goes all the way from Adam all the way to Abraham, which the text is clearly intending you to think that Abraham is a real person. There is no hint that Abraham's not real. Whereas in most ancient Near Eastern myths, it's not really obvious that you're ever supposed to take any of the people as real people. And they're usually more focused on gods than they are on people anyway. Sometimes God's creating people, but that's what they're focused on. So there has been a genre identified that basically applies to Genesis as well as potentially one group of texts from the city of Eridu that are frequently called the Eridu Genesis, but just because they're similar to Genesis, that have a similar kind of historicizing component where you have mythic stories but that are tied into people that seem to actually exist, you know, and basically narratives that are occurring in real time, in real history. So this is... this is maybe our option. So this is a very hot topic of exploration today in terms of thinking about Genesis, comparing it to these other ancient Near Eastern myths and trying to understand how we should understand it. So maybe this is our option. You know, on the non-literal side of this spectrum, that Genesis is a monotheistic Hebrew mytho-history. And now you're thinking, okay, but how does that help me at all? What does that mean in terms of interpreting what Genesis is teaching? What do you guys think? What might this mean? Obviously, probably none of you are familiar with the other examples of this literature, but if you just had to guess, what might the consequences of this being the genre of Genesis be?
I mean, it actually initially doesn't seem that far off from how we treat the rest of the Bible, because we look at that and with Jesus' parables, we look at what would have meant to the Jewish audience. And we go, well, what would they have understood first? So if we go back and apply the same, you know, reasoning there, we go, well, what would have meant to these people in the ancient Near East culture?
Yeah, so, I mean, it is the exact same thing we're doing with every other part of the Bible. It's just a different genre. And so the question is, what does that mean about how to interpret it, right? Because when you're reading the Gospels, you don't really have to wonder about, like, did this thing ever happen? Although we can talk about that with the parables. Like, are we supposed to take a parable as an actual historical event? Most of us would probably agree no. Although, again, even on that issue, there are ultra-literalists that say that if the Bible is true, obviously every parable must be referring to an actual historical event. It can't just be an illustration or a story that Jesus made up to convey a point, right?
Whenever I think of a myth, and I think of something like want to start with something I knew to be historical, and then...
Yeah, Gilgamesh might... I don't know. Is Gilgamesh a good example? What do you think, Zach? Because I don't know if it's believed, actually, that Gilgamesh was probably a real person or not. I think he might be indeterminate. I don't know if he's in any of the king lists, for example. He probably would be, though, but I don't know. But there are some examples here. So, for example, the Sumerian king list. Has anybody ever heard of this before? So this is the closest parallel to the antediluvian genealogies that we have in Genesis. Antediluvian before the flood. So where we have very long ages. So, you know, you have Methuselah living, you know, like 1,000 years, right? There are Sumerian king lists that are similar to this, but instead of like 1,000 years, it's lists of kings who are reigning for tens of thousands of years, potentially. It varies from, you know, hundreds to thousands, tens of thousands of years. But some of these kings are known to actually be real people who actually lived, and you can go find, you know, inscriptions on pieces of stone tablets or clay tablets from their reigns. And they obviously weren't actually 9,000 years old, the particular, or 900 years old, you know, the particular example that I'm thinking of. You know, and this is Sumer, you know, not the Hebrew story. So the point is, there are these, in this kind of genre, there are these people that are placed into these mythic stories with features in it that we don't understand, but they are definitely real people.
But my point in general was, is there an extent of mythologizing that crosses a certain threshold and we should say, oh, well, hold on, that's no longer acceptable? Or is there, are we prevented from drawing genuine meaning from a text because it's been mythologized?
Yeah, So there's, I think, a common error that people make, and what they'll say is that they take a default position with regards to the Bible. They say, I assume that it's literal until it's proven otherwise. This is not the right way to do hermeneutics, because remember, what are you supposed to do? You're supposed to figure out what the author intends you to take. You don't get to decide what your default position is going to be. You always have to do the work of actually figuring out what the author is trying to communicate to you. So there are no rules that we can impose on the text. The question is just, what is the author trying to communicate? What literary form are they using? And can I understand what they're trying to communicate? Which makes it really hard, because we don't know for certain what how people would have understood this type of literature, you know, 4,000 years ago. We don't know for sure. Now, importantly, clearly, non-literal accounts can be helpful, can convey important truths. There are lots of non-literal accounts in the Bible that are intended to convey important information to us. Again, parables are just stories. They're not literal historical events, but they're conveying something really important.
But they're also not starting with the kernel of history.
Not necessarily, yeah. So yeah, but that's the difficulty. We have to figure out how to suss that out, right? That's why it's not easy. It's very difficult. And you could agree with this genre and still come out on the end saying, yeah, but it's the Bible still teaches that the earth was created in 6 days. If you think that that's what the original people would have understood it, you know, is actually teaching that, right? So it's not an easy answer in any case. Okay, so let's just think about what this means a little bit. So, again, you have to think about the genre. I skipped over the C.S. Lewis quotes, but he says that you have to understand what a text is, what it's doing, and how it's being used in order to try to understand what it means. Something that we haven't talked about, except maybe in passing, is this idea of concordism. So concordism is reading science into the text. So that's where you say, okay, I believe that the earth is 4 billion years old, therefore the Bible has to mean X, Y, and Z. That's not acceptable. You can't impose an external view on the text. All you can do is see what might the original author have intended and how certain am I of that conclusion. So there are people who explicitly are concordists today. Hugh Ross is one example. But in my opinion, at least, this is not a good idea. You should not start with science and then read that into the text. You're liable to read false science into the text, for one thing.
I guess the justification for concordism for a Christian would be there are human authors, but there's also a divine author. So if we wanted to try and get some science out of the text, it could be possible.
Yeah, but what a concordist is doing is they're looking for contemporary science in the text. So Hugh Ross literally says that when I think Isaiah says that God spreads out the heavens like, what does he even say? Do you know the
heavens spread out like a tent?
Yes. That clearly what he's communicating to us is that the universe is expanding, right? That's clearly what that means, that the universe is expanding. That is definitely not what the original author meant. And I think it's fairly unlikely that God was trying to convey that information to us through the Bible. You guys can, you know, decide on your own where you want to fall on this, but I don't think concordism is a very good choice.
Yeah, I mean, I think concordism might make a little bit more sense. It all depends on how, you know, what the level of inspiration is. If it is more of a God is telling you to write these things down.
Yeah, this is important. So what is the traditional, you know, basically unanimously affirmed doctrine of inspiration in Christianity? Importantly, this is not a dictation method of inspiration. This is what is believed in Islam, for example, but uniformly Christians reject this. And we could go back to that Chicago Statement page and see what that kind of means, at least in terms of the Chicago Statement. But God is not dictating the words to people to write scripture. That's just not what any Christian theologian thinks inspiration is. No. But we won't try to defend a particular view today on that. Okay, so thinking about Genesis again, you need to put yourself into the shoes of the ancient author and the audience. And this is really difficult, which means you have to actually understand their world. You have to understand the world they were living in to try to understand what the text means. You have to cooperate with the author. You can't come to the text with preconceived notions about what the author is trying to communicate. You have to cooperate and try to get at what they're trying to tell you, which is also difficult. Genesis 1-11 is related in some way to other ancient Near Eastern texts, but the nature of that relationship is complicated, and it's very different from a lot of them. If anybody's interested, in my car I have several books of transcripts, you know, translations of these texts, and they are very different from most of the Bible, although there are important parallels in places. So it's just an interesting and complicated relationship. Some Old Testament scholars classify Genesis as mythohistory. We talked about what that is. Again, that doesn't make it that much easier to understand what it means. If Genesis is mythohistory, we can't just assume that the details are intended to be historical accounts. They might be historical accounts, but we can't assume that. It's going to take a lot more work to try to understand the way people would have understood it. Importantly, this mytho-historical genre ends in Genesis 11. This does not continue on into the rest of the Pentateuch. This is not Jesus. The resurrection is not mytho-history. It's completely different. It's ancient biography. So we're talking about just this, you know, very small part of Scripture.
Mm-hmm. What is the justification for the cutoff at Genesis 11 that most scholars...
Yeah, good. So there is at Genesis 11, there's a radical narrowing. So in the first 11 chapters, it's talking about the entire history of the universe, right? And then after chapter 11, it zooms in Abraham. And then it continues for the next third of the book, just in Abraham. And then last third of the book, so that's the patriarchal narratives, the last third of the book then is Joseph. And this is kind of a historically recognized way to break up the book.
So why is the cutoff when it zooms in on Abraham and not Noah or Adam's sons?
So the actual, like, the writing style is very different. So, for example, the account of Abraham and all of his life is not written at all like Genesis 1, or written at all like the Tower of Babel, so basically one way that can tie this all together is talking about these etiological themes, these themes that are explaining broad things about what the world is like. So we have lots of languages because the languages were confused at the Tower of Babel. The universe began to exist because in 6 days God created the world, and then he formed man out of the earth, and he formed woman from his rib, and snakes crawl on their bellies because they were cursed by God, and we have pain and suffering because we sinned against God, and now we've been cast out of the garden, and we have evil in the world, or evil has multiplied in the world because the sons of God had relations with the daughters of man, and they created these Nephilim that did terrible things and taught man to be evil. But all of these mythological, etiological themes are consistent throughout 1 to 11. And then chapter 12, you have basically prose narrative. It's not exalted anymore. It's very much just a historical account.
There are still some etiological things that occur throughout the rest of Genesis, when Jacob wrestles with God, and it says, because God touched the hip socket and
sure.
took Jacob's hip out of socket, that's why we don't eat the sinew of the hip to this day.
Yeah, so, there are still etiological themes, right? But you read that, and that's kind of out of place in that story, right? Because you expect that in Genesis 1 to 11, you don't expect that afterwards, right? Basically, if you go read Genesis, it's a very distinct cutoff.
I guess it's hard to quantify, but reading it seems.
Yeah. This isn't a quantifiable thing, but it's if you know genres and you're familiar with it, you can recognize them, right? The same reason why we don't get confused between Acts and Revelation, right? If you were to put Acts and then run it directly into Revelation, you would still immediately say, this is different. Okay, so to summarize how we've gotten so far, and we probably won't get to the second half of this today, I assume, right? What time is it?
No, 10:17.
We'll touch on it. Okay, so we'll kind of zoom through the next part. But to summarize how we've gotten so far, there are two different ways that we can respond to this argument that the Bible teaches scientific errors, and specifically Genesis 1 to 11. First of all, we can deny inerrancy and say, sure, it does. That doesn't mean the gospel is false, which is true. So if you're trying to convince somebody that the gospel is true, you do not need to defend that Genesis 1 to 11 is true. Those are two different issues, and you can deal with that. If you convert somebody to Christianity, then you can deal with what they think about Genesis 1 to 11. Don't get those things backwards. I see this way too often where you see somebody arguing with an atheist about how, trees through multiple rock strata prove that the earth is young. One, you're never going to win that argument. Two, if you did win that argument, they're still not Christians. So what's the point? So don't do it. Okay.
I think more importantly, though, there are Christians that also disagree on that as Christians.
Yeah, yeah. That's the important point. There are a large number of conservative evangelical Christians, let's make that qualification, that are going to disagree with any particular view of a scientific conflict when it comes to Genesis. There are hundreds of different positions that are defended by, evangelical conservative Christians with PhDs in relevant areas. And we can go into the, dozen or so books that we used as source material for all of this, so you can see what some of those perspectives are. Now, as I said, there's still another question here. And this is probably more difficult and cuts a little bit closer. So this is that if the gospel is fundamentally based on flawed science, then it can't be true. But the gospel is fundamentally based on flawed science, therefore it can't be true. Now, what flawed science are we talking about here? Because we're actually talking about a specific example at this point. This is no longer the age of the earth or biological evolution or something like that. Because this is something that's going to connect us away from Genesis and to Romans. Is Romans mythohistory? No. So when Paul says something, we have to take that very differently than something that's in Genesis 1 to 11. So specifically what we're talking about here is Adam and Eve. So here's an example objection. genetics has proven the Adam and Eve story in Genesis to be impossible. Without Adam and Eve, there would be no original sin. Without original sin, there would be no need for Jesus. Without Jesus, the Christian religion falls apart completely. The whole religion is based on and relies upon a story that could not possibly be true. All evidence points to this fact. So again, we can do the same thing that we did before. We can say, okay, Paul made a mistake. We'll talk about exactly what Paul's talking about. This is less of an option than it is even in the previous one. You're still denying inerrancy too, because this is actually about core theology, right? So if Paul is making an error in his core theology, then that's a problem. So another option, again, we can deny instead premise two, that the gospel is based on a flawed science. So again, we have to answer those same two questions. What does the Bible actually teach? And in this case, we're going to be looking at Romans. And what does science actually demonstrate? Okay? So, biblical data. So there are a lot of touch points on the historicity of Adam and Eve in the Bible. Obviously, there's Genesis. Then we have the genealogies. These start in Genesis, but they are also New Testament genealogies that include Adam. Again, genealogy is kind of a big deal. They're not really mythical, even in Genesis, certainly not in Luke. Then we have Paul's incidental treatment of Adam in Acts. Ironically, just think about this. There are almost no references in the Old Testament to Adam. There's like one reference other than Genesis. Yeah, it's in Chronicles. Does it say that up there? Yes. No, it doesn't. Oh, genealogy. There you go. So the point is, you know, back then they didn't necessarily think that he was that important. But by the time we get to Luke, like, Adam, important, right? So, and then the most important text, which we're not even going to talk about these early ones. We're going to go just to this last one. Paul argues in Romans 5 that Adam and Christ are related in an important way. And that's a comparison that should make you uneasy if you're worried that Adam didn't really exist. So here's a heavily edited section of Romans 5, 12 through 19. But I've highlighted on here every reference to Adam and every reference to Jesus. So it says, sin entered the world through Adam, and death through sin, and na-da-da-da-da, but Adam was in the pattern of the one to come, Jesus. So for many people died because of the trespass of one man, Adam. So how much more did the gift of grace flow from one man, Jesus Christ? So direct comparison. If by the trespasses of one man, Adam, death reigned, how much more will those who receive God's abundant provision through the one man, Jesus Christ? Just as trespass resulted in condemnation for all people, so for one righteous act resulted in the justification and life for all people. Again, Adam did something that caused death for everybody. Jesus did something that caused life for everybody. As disobedience of one man, Adam, many were made sinners. Through the obedience of one man, Jesus, many will be made righteous. Okay? So Paul is very clearly drawing this parallel, and he's placing Adam into the real history of the world and giving him causal power over us today. So he's saying that there are features of the world that are the result of what Adam did. This means that Adam can't be a mythical figure that never really existed, because Paul is claiming that he did something that impacts us, right? So he can't just be a person in a story, right? If I claim to you that, Frodo Baggins has some causal effect on the world, you're going to say I'm crazy because he's not a real entity. So clearly Paul is meaning that Adam is. So this only works. His message is only reasonable if Adam is a real historical person.
Real quick, are we doing New Testament concordism by saying if Adam was considered to be a mythological history by the original author, but then because of what the New Testament says, we have to put that back into Genesis? Is that New Testament concordism?
So Yeah, so this is like an intertextual concordism. So it's another thing is you shouldn't read in, like, you shouldn't read the New Testament into the Old Testament in terms of understanding its original meaning, but you can think of the New Testament as a divinely inspired commentary on the Old Testament, in the words of Michael Heiser. But I think importantly, even in the original, in the mytho-historical figure, remember the point is that the genealogies of that mytho-history are supposedly relating real people. So most likely, the way, however you're going to interpret Genesis 1 to 11, Adam is real in the context of 1:11 too. And then here's Paul also saying that he was a real person. Right? Okay, so this is important. So what does this mean? So now there are two key scientific claims that we should think about that are going to cause the challenge here. The first is that modern human beings, Homo sapiens, share a common ancestor with other primates, and two, that the ancestral population of human beings has never been lower than a few thousand. So there were never just two people. Okay? This is, at least purportedly, this is what contemporary genetics teaches us about, population genetics teaches us about the history of the human race. Yeah, I mean, the point is that individuals don't evolve, populations evolve, right? So the population as a whole changes over time and eventually goes from something that we would consider non-human to something we consider human, but it's still a group.
I mean, species is itself kind of a vague term, like just because, you know.
Yeah, I mean, there is no rigorous definition of a species that's, you know, uniformly agreed on, right?
Yeah, there's multiple different definitions and they don't always overlap, and there'll be times when something would be considered the same species or different species with one definition, and it contradicts the other a different definition.
Yeah.
It's all very muddy
and importantly, for our purpose, we're not even talking about a scientific definition of species. We're talking about the theological definition of a human being, right? So those two things are different. So that might be an important point of consideration. Now, there are lots of different models of Adam and Eve, like who were they, when did they live, et cetera, et cetera. We're going to go real briefly through a few of these. So the first is the individual biological ancestor, which just basically means in the last 10,000 years or so, there were literally two people, and all people are directly, are descended from them in some way. There's a couple different ways that that could be even. Individual representative ancestors. So Adam and Eve were selected from a population to federally represent the human race. But there were other people in addition to Adam and Eve. Then you have group representative ancestors. Adam and Eve were prominent members of a group that was selected by God for special revelation. And then literary representative figures, which basically says that they're just a literary representative and don't necessarily actually exist as real people. Okay, so Adam and the Genome. So this is a book by Douglas Venema, and he claims, Dennis Venema. And so he's a believer, right? But he claims that actually, yes, the scientific record is incompatible with Adam and Eve within the last 9 million years. He says that this is as certain as that the sun is at the center of our solar system. He says our lineage has not experienced an extreme population bottleneck in the last 9 million years. That is a population less than 1,000 or something like that. This has been shown to be false, though. So there's a whole bunch of reasons for this, but there's a fairly recent book that was by Joshua Swamidas, called the Genealogical Adam, and he goes through this, and he's published this in a couple different forums, and Venema has agreed. Say, okay, if it was within the last 500,000 years, we would know. So basically, there couldn't have been a pair of just two people, like alone, within the last 500,000 years. But if it was longer ago than that, then we wouldn't be able to detect it. Okay, so The point here is that there are lots of different models of Adam and Eve. The science basically says that probably there was not a convergence down to a single pair within the last 500,000 years. There could have been before then. Of these different views, individual biological ancestors, basically the idea here is this might be contradicted by genetics if you think it was recent within the last 9,000 years. However, Swamidas's book is all about a way to describe this that is consistent with this, that is also consistent with genetics, which requires that there's not just a population of two. This is the genealogical Adam. We're not going to talk about what that is, but the point is there's a model for that. We have the individual representative ancestors. This actually fits reasonably well with scripture. It does fix things like wondering where Cain's wife came from and stuff like that. And it could be compatible with science depending on how long ago it was. You have the group representative ancestors, which doesn't really jive with what Genesis is saying. Maybe it's right, but it doesn't. That's not what Genesis is communicating, it seems. It could be compatible with science, though. And then we have the literary representative figures, which basically is ruled out by Paul, like, because this says they're not real people, which we've already discussed. But it doesn't make any scientific claims, so you're guaranteed to not run afoul of genetics. Okay, so summary of this. So obviously we have not talked very much at all. For reference, we talked about just the topic of Adam and Eve for an hour and a half last fall. Just that topic. We just did it in like 15 minutes. So there's a lot more to be said. But we can kind of conclude this. We can say that, first of all, science does not rule out a literal Adam. There are at least a handful of different ways that you can have a literal Adam in a way that's consistent with the Bible and with science. Those options exist. You can always, again, deny inerrancy and just say, yeah, Paul was wrong. Again, not a good choice in this situation. Okay, so conclusion and summary. So we have just spent like an hour going through this. And honestly, we've talked about very little, right? Yeah, but very little. So again, the content that this is based on, we have three YouTube videos from last fall, each of which is an hour and a half long. So all of these topics are handled in more detail. So if you're curious, you can go look back at those. And we'll obviously at Revs, and if we have any time here, we'll talk about any other kind of secondary issues that you guys might want to talk about. But as a reminder, the argument here is that you can't believe the gospel because science is in such massive contradiction with the Bible that it would just not make sense in the modern world to even consider that the gospel might be true. Specifically in these three areas, cosmology, biology, and anthropology. We have these two different arguments, but we have multiple responses that we can make here. So remember, the goal is not a systematic theology. Our goal is apologetics and evangelism. So how are we going to convince the people we're talking to that the gospel is true? Not at this stage right now. How are we going to create our own systematic theology that answers all questions of what the Bible means and what Christianity teaches? Importantly, we should not require a non-believer to accept biblical inerrancy prior to accepting the gospel. We also shouldn't require that they accept something like that the earth is 6,000 years old. So if you believe that, if you believe the earth is 6,000 years old and you're talking to somebody, just say, okay, maybe I'm wrong that the earth is 6,000 years old and there's a different way to interpret Genesis, but what about the gospel? What do you think about that, right? Don't focus on the secondary issues that aren't going to get you anywhere. Focus on what the core purpose of you talking to a non-believer is. And importantly, there are many views of Genesis and of Adam and Eve and all of these things that are not a problem in terms of science. You may have to go and evaluate all of those to see which ones you actually think are valid. But there are lots of options out there that are held by very smart people who are conservative evangelicals, if that's what you're worried about. And so especially for just using those as possibilities to interact with a non-believer, it's a great option. Now lastly, as I said at the beginning, what I talked about today is not necessarily congruent with the position that the national organization Ratio Christi may hold or believe. Here is their official statement of faith, which I'm not going, or as relevant to these topics, or some of these topics. I'm not going to read this. You guys can find it on the Ratio Christi website. Once this is eventually posted to YouTube, you'll be able to see this and go back and read it if you're curious. Okay, so like I've said, there is a lot of other material out there. So if you want to see some of the things that we've talked about in the past, we have, again, these three meetings that were recorded last fall. So about 4.5 hours total of just talking about these issues and talking about some of the scientific evidences and a lot more different interpretive issues and interpretations and a lot more Bible and a lot more of a lot of things. So if you're curious, just go take a look at those. You can find them at the Ratio Christi at Texas A&M YouTube page. We also have a variety of episodes on our podcast that may be relevant. So you can hear from some of these people that we've referenced today, Dr. Joshua Swamidas, Paul Nelson, who is a young earth creationist, Michael Behe, who is a fairly famous intelligent design advocate. So you can go, you know, hear some of their thoughts in the context of our Ratio Christi chapter as well. Some of the books that I relied on heavily for this, so Reading Genesis Well is a book by C. John Collins. He's an Old Testament scholar. And the discussion of genre in Genesis is largely taken from him, as well as from William Lane Craig. A lot of the content from Adam is taken from Craig's new book and his podcast, which you can see here. Yes. And lastly, we have, over the years, gone through a lot of different materials, and there are a lot of good resources out there. If you're interested in this topic, though, don't just read one book, because there are lots of different positions out there, and no one author is going to be able to convey them all to you. So here's a small sampling of some of the different resources that we've used over the year and some of the books that describe some of the views that we've covered. If you are interested in borrowing one of these books, between Zach and myself, we have at least one, if not more, copies of all of these, also of Sam. If you're interested in further reading, just let us know and we can get you a book. I actually have most of these books in my car right now. I thought about bringing them up here and stacking them up, but it's like 11 books, and I had to carry all this stuff instead. So
what do you think?
What do I think? I don't know what I think. So, that's it. I think, are we out of time?
Yeah, we're fine.
So we're out of time. So we have a whole bunch more stuff to talk about on this topic. So we're going to head down to Revs right now. And I actually have, that was about 45 slides. I have another 100 slides in this slide deck with lots of additional material. This slide deck started out as 250 slides and I cut it down. So we can continue talking for a while. So thank you guys.